So hey everyone, welcome back to Learn Life Science. Myself Vinita Tiwari, and today again we are going to discuss another practical which is related with enzymes. Okay, so in my previous videos we have already discussed practicals on enzyme, like quantitative determination of maltose was one of the practical in which we quantitatively determine the maltose released by starch hydrolysis, okay, in the presence of enzyme alpha amylase. Then we have also discussed regarding the construction of standard graph, then how you can calculate the slope from standard graph, and then we have moved towards the calculation of enzyme activity in detail. Okay, so moving on, next we are today going to discuss about the in vitro determination of Km and Vmax of enzyme alpha amylase. Okay, so the protocol will be based on the determination of Km and Vmax for alpha amylase by double reciprocal plot, which is also known as Lineweaver-Burk plot. Okay, so first we are going to discuss the protocol, means the protocol which you will need to follow in the laboratory. Okay, and then after getting the absorbance, after getting the OD, we are going to move forward towards the calculation and then finally towards the graph. Okay, so we are going to discuss firstly the working principle, the basic principle about Km and Vmax. Okay, then the requirements and the observation table that you will need to follow for the protocols. Okay, then moving forward we will discuss how you can plot the LB, how you can plot LB plot, okay, double reciprocal plot, and then we are going to calculate the substrate concentration, obviously, then initial velocity, maximum velocity Km, and the slope, which is Km by Vmax. Okay, and finally we are going to have the results in our hand. Okay, so let's get started. So firstly, discussing about the principle, we will start with the Michaelis-Menten theory. Okay, so Michaelis-Menten theory generally assumes that enzymes first combines with the substrate to form enzyme substrate complex, which further breaks down in the second step to form free enzyme as well as the product. Okay, so we all know the simple equation of Michaelis-Menten, which is given by E plus S means the enzyme plus substrate will give you at the rate of K plus 1 the enzyme substrate complex. Further, this enzyme substrate complex will break down at the rate of K plus 2 and will give you free enzyme as well as the product. Okay, this enzyme substrate complex at the transition state is having the ability to revert the reaction back to enzyme plus substrate, which is done at the rate of K minus 1. Okay, so this is the general reaction which was given by Michaelis-Menten. They assume that the reaction to proceed in this manner. Okay, then following this thing, means knowing this equation in their mind, they constructed the Michaelis-Menten equation. Okay, they generally assumed to find equation or to find a derivation for the initial velocity for this reaction. Okay, they generally determined a way to calculate the initial velocity of this reaction. Okay, you know, initial velocity means the rate, the initial rate which is required to for the reaction to occur. Okay, for the reaction to take place. Okay, moving on, next, this is the Michaelis-Menten equation for one substrate catalyzed reaction. Okay, this is the general equation we already know, which is given by V0 is equal to Vmax into substrate concentration divided by Km plus S, where Vmax is the maximum rate of enzyme catalyzed reaction when the enzyme is completely saturated. So generally Vmax is the final point where the enzymes are completely saturated. Completely saturated means the enzymes are present in enzyme substrate complex form. Means each and every enzyme present in the sample is present as a complex with the substrate. Okay, then Km, it generally indicates the Michaelis-Menten constant. Okay, Michaelis-Menten constant means it generally gives you the rate of dissociation divided by the rate of formation of ES complex. Okay, that I have already discussed in my previous videos. Okay, then V0 gives you the initial rate of reaction, as I have already told you that Michaelis-Menten tried to derive an equation for defining the initial velocity of reaction. Okay, initial rate of reaction. Then S generally gives you the substrate concentration. Okay, the substrate you are using for the reaction to take place. Okay, so now, so if we talk about the calculation of Km and Vmax from this equation, we generally know that it will not give you a proper data, means it will not give you an accurate data of Vmax as well as Km. Okay, this, after following this equation, it generally gives you a hyperbola curve. Okay, when we plot substrate concentration versus initial rate of velocity, it generally gives us hyperbolic plot. Okay, and this is the Vmax, as well as the half of Vmax give you the Km. Okay, so Km is the generally the substrate concentration at which Vmax is half. It is the substrate concentration at which Vmax is generally half. Okay, so this thing is followed only in a particular condition. Okay, this is not always the case. So keep in mind that it will not give you a accurate data regarding Km and Vmax. So therefore, for getting accurate results or to get the accurate data of Km and Vmax, we go through Lineweaver-Burk plot or the double reciprocal plot. So the exact value of Vmax can be determined on the basis of Lineweaver-Burk equation. Okay, so this equation is nothing but the reciprocal of the Michaelis-Menten equation. Okay, after reciprocaling the equation of Michaelis-Menten and after solving it, you will have this equation. Okay, so Lineweaver-Burk or double reciprocal plot will give you this equation, in which you can see 1 by V0, that is 1 by initial velocity, will give you Km by Vmax multiplied by 1 by substrate concentration plus 1 by Vmax. Okay, if you will see properly, it will give you the data like Y is equal to Mx plus C. Okay, that gives you, in the sense, 1 by V0 will be plotted on Y axis, Km by Vmax is the slope, 1 by substrate concentration will be plotted on X axis. Okay, and C is 1 by Vmax. C means it is the y-intercept point. Okay, on y-axis, the intercept you will get will be 1 by Vmax. Okay, so this is the double reciprocal plot which we generally study theoretically. Okay, we already know about this theoretical double reciprocal plot. So I have kept here the equation 2, which is y is equals to mx plus C. You can see here, on y axis 1 by initial velocity is plotted, and on x axis 1 by substrate concentration is plotted. Okay, on getting a linear line, you can see here the line is generally from the negative point. Okay, from the negative point you will see a linear line. Okay, why this linear line is from negative axis, you will also get to know in this video. So the intercept you get on y axis will be the 1 by Vmax. Okay, will be 1 by Vmax. Okay, it is a positive line, means the value we will get will be in positive. Okay, then the slope, means the slope we have Km by Vmax, you can calculate through here. We are also going to calculate this Km by Vmax through the double reciprocal plot. Okay, also on the 1 by substrate concentration, 1 by substrate concentration, which is present on x axis, you are going to get an intercept present right here, which will give you minus 1 by Km. Why minus? Because it is present on the minus quadrant. Okay, so I hope you are clear with this double reciprocal plot. Okay, we have already studied theoretically regarding all these things. Okay, so now we are going to start with the protocol that you will require to determine the Km and Vmax. As I have already told you, we are discussing particularly or specifically regarding alpha amylase. So alpha amylase is an enzyme, is a hydrolytic enzyme which catalyzes the hydrolysis of starch, which is a polysaccharide, into maltose and dextrin. Okay, so as you can see here, starch is hydrolyzed into maltose and dextrin. Maltose being a reducing sugar, it can reduce other agents, okay, other reagents. For example, we can quantify the maltose present in the sample by DNSA reagent. Okay, DNSA means dinitrosalicylic acid, which is reduced by this reducing sugar, and it will give you final red end product. The end product means the end product of the reaction tube will be red color. Okay, so it generally converts the yellow dinitrosalicylic acid reagent into a red color complex form. Okay, and दिस रिएक्शन कैन ओनली बी टेकन अप बाय द रिड्यूसिंग शुगर्स. ओके, फॉर एग्जाम्पल माल्टोज एज वेल एज लैक्टोज एज वेल एज ग्लूकोज. ओके, रिड्यूसिंग शुगर्स आर दोज विच आर हैविंग फ्री अल्डिहाइड और कीटो ग्रुप. ओके, सो दिस इज द बेसिक थिंग. ओके, वी ऑलरेडी नो. नाउ द फर्स्ट थिंग, द फर्स्ट रिक्वायरमेंट दैट यू विल नीड, द फर्स्ट थिंग यू विल नीड बिफोर स्टेपिंग इन टू द प्रोटोकॉल इज द स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ माल्टोज. ओके, और पर्टिकुलरली स्पीकिंग द स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ द प्रोडक्ट. ओके, द स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ द प्रोडक्ट दैट यू विल गेट आफ्टर द रिएक्शन. फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई एम टेकिंग हियर अल्फा अमाइलेज एंड द एंड प्रोडक्ट ऑफ दिस रिएक्शन मीन्स द प्रोडक्ट ऑफ दिस रिएक्शन इज माल्टोज. सो आई एम गोइंग टू हैव द स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ माल्टोज ऑलरेडी विथ मी. वाई? बिकॉज दिस स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ माल्टोज विल गिव मी द स्लोप. ओके, स्लोप इज जनरली रिक्वायर्ड फॉर द डिटर्मिनेशन ऑफ अननोन कॉन्सेंट्रेशन, दैट इज द सैम्पल कॉन्सेंट्रेशन. ओके, दैट इज द अननोन यू हैव इन योर हैंड. ओके, सो स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ माल्टोज, आई हैव ऑलरेडी प्रिपेयर्ड वीडियोज ऑन स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ ऑफ माल्टोज प्रिपरेशन, विच आई विल गिव यू द लिंक इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन बॉक्स. ओके, आई हैव ऑल्सो प्रिपेयर्ड सेपरेट वीडियो फॉर द कैलकुलेशन ऑफ स्लोप फ्रॉम द स्टैंडर्ड ग्राफ. ओके, सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट यू विल रिक्वायर. So, on behalf of this video, we are having the slope of around, after the complete calculation, we are having the slope of 0.0096. Okay, this is the slope. Okay, so we will consider 0.0096 as the slope for today's protocol. Okay, now, the second thing you will require is the unknown concentration. Okay, means the test you are performing, you will require the its concentration. Okay, for example, you will need the microgram of product released, or you can say it as the unknown concentration. Why I am saying here microgram? Because we generally calculate the concentration of unknown in microgram per ml unit. Okay, therefore I am considering it here as microgram of product released or unknown concentration. Okay, so how we are going to get this unknown concentration? Simply we are going to divide the absorbance of the unknown, means the test sample, by the slope. Which slope? This slope which we have already calculated. Okay, so second thing is the microgram of product released we will have, and then we will just simply divide the absorbance by the slope. Okay, now moving on, next the final thing means the last second step will be the calculation of enzyme activity. I have already prepared a detailed video regarding how you can calculate the enzyme activity of alpha amylase. Okay, in today's video also I am going to show you how you can calculate enzyme activity, but for detailed knowledge I will suggest you to go through this video. Okay, so enzyme activity means it is the micromole of substrate which is converted into product per minute. Okay, its unit is micromole per minute. We generally designate it by capital U, which indicates unit. Okay, so enzyme activity will give you the result in micromole per minute. Okay, micromole per minute means we are simply converting this microgram into micromole per minute. Okay, this is the simple thing right here. Okay, so we are starting with the protocol. Okay, I have already discussed the three steps that you will require before starting the protocol. Okay, so for calculating the enzyme activity, I am talking about the third step, that is the calculation of enzyme activity. I am giving you just a little idea. Okay, so right here you can see the same equation I have already mentioned, that starch is hydrolyzed into maltose and dextrin. So what is enzyme activity here? So enzyme activity is the micromole of product which is formed per unit time, means the micromole of product which is produced per minute. Okay, you can say it in either way, as the micromole of substrate converted into product per unit time, or you can say it as the micromole of product which is formed per unit time. Okay, this is one and the same thing. Then the enzyme activity can be calculated from the microgram of maltose released. Okay, for calculating the enzyme activity, you will have to calculate the microgram of maltose which is liberated in the reaction. Okay, so for that you will have to follow the DNSA method. Okay, and for this we are going to perform the DNSA method. okay, I hope you are getting all the basics. Okay, I'm just discussing the background of all this practical. Okay, so let's now get started with the determination of Km and Vmax. So basically, I'm going to first tell you regarding the requirements that you will need, and finally we will move toward the observation table. Okay, now I'm keeping in mind that you are clear with all the things I have told you till yet. Okay, so the requirements will be simple. You will require starch 1%. Starch 1% means simply 1 gram of starch in 100 ml distilled water. Okay, so we all know that starch is not easily dissolved in water. We generally boil it, okay, on the burner so that it dissolves completely. Okay, so before initiating the reaction, just keep in mind that you are completely dissolving the substrate. Okay, so just take 1 gram of starch and dissolve it in 100 ml of distilled water. Okay, now you know this thing that 1 gram is for 100 ml. Okay, so 1 gram is for 100 ml, then we can say that final reaction, okay, I will discuss it further. Okay, so you will also require phosphate buffer of pH 7. Okay, you will also require a phosphate buffer of pH 7. Why pH 7? Because pH 7 is the optimum pH for alpha amylase. Okay, so pH 7 is the optimum pH for alpha amylase. Okay, then the third thing is the requirement of the enzyme, which is alpha amylase, and you will require it for about 0.1%, means 0.1 gram of alpha amylase in 100 ml of distilled water. Okay, and then finally you will require DNSA reagent. Okay, so I will try to give you the composition of DNSA reagent in the description box so that you can go through that. Okay, so this is the protocol that you will need to follow in the laboratory. Okay, so the laboratory work is only this much. Okay, the remaining part is only about the calculation as well as the graph. Okay, so beginning with the substrate. Okay, so zero means it is the blank tube. Okay, we generally need to prepare the blank tube. Okay, so starch 1%. Okay, so you are going to prepare a set of around 10 test tubes, okay, and go through this addition, means 0.1 ml, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4 till 1 ml. Okay, you are going to add the substrate starch. Okay, then after the addition of starch, please don't add the substrate in the blank tube. Okay, there is no addition of starch in the blank test tube. Okay, remember this thing, because if you will add starch, means if you will add substrate in the blank tube, then it is having the ability to react in a little amount or little percentage with the DNSA reagent. Okay, so don't add substrate in the blank test tube. Okay, otherwise it will give you a red color complex. Then the buffer that you have prepared of pH 7 will be added in this proportion. Okay, means we are making here up to 2 ml. Okay, sorry, 1 ml. So we are making up it till 1 ml with distilled water. So in blank test tube, add 1 ml distilled water. Then in 0.1 tube, add 0.9 ml distilled water, buffer, and so on. Okay, this is the addition of buffer till makeup volume of 1 ml. Okay, then after that, add the enzyme amylase. Okay, the enzyme amylase. In each tube, including blank, you will have to add 1 ml of enzyme. Okay, in each tube there will be addition of enzyme, okay, including the blank. Don't forget regarding the blank. Okay, then for the reaction to occur, we are going to incubate it at room temperature. Okay, I am highlighting it here that you will require to incubate the test tubes at room temperature for 10 minutes. Okay, 10 minutes will be sufficient for the reaction to take place. Okay, after 10 minutes there will be addition of DNSA. Okay, we are adding DNSA after 10 minutes so that the product which is formed, maltose, after this reaction will react with DNSA reagent. Okay, so addition of DNSA will be 1 ml in each test tube. Okay, so for the further reaction to occur between maltose and DNSA, you will further need to keep it in boiling water bath for around 10 minutes. Okay, so you will have to keep it in boiling water bath for around 10 minutes. And Then after cooling it down under running tap water, you are going to take the absorbance at 540 nm. Okay, so one more point is that if your tubes are densely red, means if your tubes are dark red, then do dilute it with distilled water. Okay, do dilute it with distilled water so you will get a minimum absorbance in accurate form. Okay, and if you are diluting the tubes, dilute the tubes, dilute every tubes. Okay, don't dilute any one of the tube. Okay, dilute each 10 test tubes. Okay, including the blank also. Okay, then so we are having here the absorbance. Okay, after following the protocol, you are having the absorbance in your hand, this absorbance. Okay, now moving up forward, I'm going to introduce more column in this table. Okay, so for determining Km and Vmax, you will require 1 by substrate concentration. Okay, then why 1 by substrate concentration? Because we are going to plot 1 by substrate concentration on x-axis, right? Then for calculation of enzyme activity, means initial velocity, you must say V0. For calculating enzyme activity, we will require the microgram of maltose released, or in simple word, the unknown concentration. Okay, so these three things we will need to find through this table. Okay, so the first thing is the calculation of 1 by substrate concentration. So we have already prepared the substrate starch by 1%. Okay, so there is a little mistake in this table. Just keep in mind that we are taking starch of around 0.1%. Okay, we are taking this starch around 0.1%. 0.1%, that you will need 0.1 gram in 100 ml. Okay, because I have calculated it in this manner. Okay, I have calculated that for 1 ml, the concentration will be 1000 microgram per ml. Okay, so this is the protocol according to me. Okay, so I have taken 1 microgram per ml concentration. Okay, so the substrate concentration will be 1000 microgram per ml. How 1000 microgram? As you can see, 0.1 gram will be taken for 100 ml. That means I can also take it as 100 milligram for 100 ml. Okay, we know that 1 gram is equal to 1000 milligram. Okay, similarly, 1 milligram is equal to 1000 microgram. Okay, so I can take it in the form of 1 milligram will be equal to 1 ml. Okay, means 1 milligram per ml is the concentration right here. So taking it in milligram form, we will take it in microgram form. Okay, so we will take it in 1000 microgram for 1 ml. Okay, so this will give you, this 1 ml will give you a 1000 microgram concentration. Okay, 1000 microgram concentration. Similarly, you can calculate it for 0.9, it will give you 900, then 800, 700, 600, 500, 400, 300, 200 and 100. Okay, there will be no concentration for the blank tube. Okay, so just correct it right here. Then for calculating 1 by substrate concentration, we will simply need to calculate it by dividing it by 1. Okay, just divide this substrate concentration by 1. So you will get that 1 divided by 100 is 0.01, 1 divided by 200 is 0.005, 1 divided by 300, then 1 divided by 400, 1 divided by 500, 1 divided by 600, 1 divided by 700, 1 divided by 800, 1 divided by 900 and 1 divided by 1000. So it will give you this 1 by substrate concentration, which I have highlighted in red color. Okay, so we have 1 by substrate concentration in our hand. Okay, now the second thing is the calculation of microgram of maltose, or the calculation of unknown concentration. Okay, so for this thing you will need OD. Okay, the absorbance. Okay, so we already know that microgram of maltose, microgram of product or microgram of maltose will be equal to OD upon slope. Okay, we are having the slope 0.00096 and the OD will be respective for each tube. okay, take the respective absorbance of each tube to calculate the micrograms of product which is released. Okay, for example, I am taking this first tube, the absorbance is 0.057. So microgram of maltose released will be 0.057 divided by 0.0096. Okay, it will give you 60.39, okay, which is microgram per ml. Okay, then next is 0.157 divided by 0.0096. Okay, then third one is 0.321 divided by 0.0096. Okay, so I am mentioning here the slope. Okay, so in this manner you are going to get the microgram of maltose or the unknown concentration. Okay, now so the second thing is also calculated, two things are done. Now finally we are going to calculate the enzyme activity or the initial velocity. Okay, so for calculating enzyme activity, which gives you the unit in the form of micromole of product converted, micromole of product formed per unit time. Okay, so the formula which is generally used for the calculation of enzyme activity is the microgram of maltose released, which we have just calculated. It will be multiplied by 1000 and divided by the molecular weight of maltose and multiply it by the incubation time. Okay, I am taking here maltose because the maltose is the product of our reaction. Okay, maltose is the product of alpha amylase. Okay, so if you are working on some another enzyme, so take the product which is liberated at the time of reaction. Okay, so microgram of product release multiplied by 1000 divided by molecular weight of maltose multiplied by incubation time. Okay, so microgram of maltose released we have already calculated. Okay, multiplied by 1000, divide it by molecular weight of maltose, which is 342, and multiply it by the incubation time. So this incubation time will be the incubation time at room temperature, which we have done at for 10 minutes. Okay, so this will be the incubation time which you have taken for room temperature incubation. Okay, for example, we have incubated the test tubes for 10 minutes at room temperature. So I'm considering only this incubation time. Okay, don't consider the incubation time which you have used for the DNSA and maltose reaction or the boiling water bath incubation time. Okay, do not consider that incubation time. Okay, so using this formula you can calculate the enzyme activity. For example, I am taking the first test tube. Okay, so microgram of maltose released is 60.39, multiply it by 1000. Why we are multiplying it by 1000? Because the answer is in microgram, so we are simply converting it in micromole. Okay, for the conversion you will require the molecular weight and you will also require multiplying it by 1000. 60.39 multiplied by 1000 divided by 342 into incubation time, it will give you 17.66. second one is 164.57 multiplied by 1000 divided by 342 into 10, it will give you 48.12. similarly, the next one is 335.29 multiplied by 1000 divided by 342.10, it will give you 98.03. and similarly you can calculate the further readings. Remember one thing, that with the increase in substrate concentration, okay, with the increase in substrate concentration, the enzyme activity will also increase. Okay, so if you are having errors, so if you are having errors in the OD, for example, your absorbance, your OD is in decreasing form, means you have not performed the protocol properly. Okay, the OD must increase. Okay, the OD must increase linearly. Okay, if there is one to two test tubes which are giving you back and forth reading, so it doesn't matter. Okay, just remember one thing, that most of the test tubes, around 7 to 8 test tubes, should give you the readings in increasing form. Okay, so that the enzyme activity you calculate will be also in increasing form. As you can see here, the enzyme activity is reached from 17.66 to 242.44. why we are seeing here the increase in enzyme activity? Because the test tube are arranged in such a manner that the concentration of substrate is increasing, okay, from 0.1 ml to 1 ml. Okay, so we have calculated the enzyme activity in micromole per minute. Okay, so finally you are having 1 by substrate concentration, and now you are also having the enzyme activity. Okay, so if you remember the plot, 1 by substrate concentration will be on x-axis and 1 by initial velocity will be on y-axis. Okay, so this, in the same manner you have calculated the substrate, 1 by substrate concentration, you will have to calculate the 1 by V0. Okay, so just divide 1 by 17.66, 1 by 48.12, 1 by 98.03, and so on. Okay, just divide these numbers by 1, so that you can get your y-axis point, which will be 1 by V0. Okay, so now you have the points that you will need to plot on the graph. Okay, so you have the 1 by substrate concentration point as well as the 1 by initial velocity points. Okay, so now we will discuss regarding the graph. Okay, we will now try to plot the double reciprocal plot, also known as Lineweaver-Burk plot. Okay, so this is the same table. So just see one thing, that the 1 by substrate concentration is decreasing. Okay, if you will observe that, if you will observe properly, that the 1 by substrate concentration is decreasing. Why it is decreasing? Because we have divided it by 1. Okay, we have reciprocaled it. So you will see that it is decreasing from 0.01 to 0.001. okay, and if you want to plot it on x-axis, you will have to keep in mind that you are plotting it from the decreasing point. Okay, so we will plot it from 0.001, then 0.002, then 0.003, okay, and so on. Just a minute, I will plot it properly. Like 0.001, then 0.002, 0.003, and till 0.010. okay, so we will have to plot the points from decreasing to increasing manner. Okay, don't plot it in reverse direction, plot it in increasing form. Okay, so plot it in this direction. Okay, whichever plot you are plotting, or on whichever enzyme you are performing, just plot it in increasing manner. In the very similar way, you will have to plot it on y-axis. Okay, you can see here the 1 by V0 value is in decreasing form. Okay, but you will have to plot it in increasing form. We are going to plot it properly, you will see it further, but just plot the numbers in increasing form. Okay, for example, here I will take it 0.001, then 0.002, then 0.003, then 0.004, and so on. Okay, so plot it in increasing direction. Okay, so you will get an idea soon. So this is the final table. Okay, I have piled up everything in this one table, so that you can take the screenshot of this table and use it for your data. Okay, use it for your protocol. Okay, everything is mentioned in this table. Now, okay, now let's get started with plotting the graph. Okay, so I'm just considering it here two things. Okay, 1 by substrate concentration as well as 1 by initial velocity, which was the main aim of this protocol. Okay, so now we are having 1 by substrate concentration and 1 by initial velocity. Okay, so as I've already told you, just plot the points in increasing order. Okay, for example, I have plotted 1 by substrate concentration. Just see here, 0.001. So I have started from 0.001, then 0.002, 0.003. okay, the maximum limit is 0.01. okay, so I have plotted it till 0.001. okay, so 0.001, 0.002, 0.003, and so on. It is the 1 by substrate concentration axis, on x-axis. Okay, then the y-axis point will be the same. I have plotted it as y-axis. 1 centimeter will be equal to 0.001. okay, remember this thing. Okay, the unit will be in micromole per minute, and its unit will be in microgram. Okay, which we will discuss further. So this is 0.001, 0.002, 0.003, 0.004, and I have taken it till 0.020, means this second value. Okay, this value is very much on the top, so we will take it till 0.020. Okay, so this is the manner in which you will have to plot the points. Okay, for example, if we plot the points directly, so the first point is for at 0.01, we are having the reading of 0.056. Means, sorry, just plot it in reverse direction. The first one is at 0.001, we are having reading of 0.0041. Okay, means, which means this is 0.001 and we are having 0.0041, means, which means it will give you reading at point here. Okay. Then at 0.0011, means just the next point to this will give you reading of 0.0044, means just above this. Just a minute. Okay, I have taken this directly so that we can plot it. So this is the 0.001 point, which is 0.0041, right? Then the another point is at 0.0011 is 0.0044, means right here. Okay, then the third one is at 0.00125, means similarly next to this point will be 0.0048, again at this point. Then 0.00143 means here it is 0.0052. okay, so in this manner you can plot the graph. Okay, I hope you understood it well. You will need to plot the graph in reverse direction. Okay, so because we have taken the points in increasing order, so you will need to plot the graph in reverse direction. Okay, so you will get a straight line from this negative point. Okay, the points will be plotted at this quadrant. Okay, the point will be plotted in this quadrant, but you can see here no straight line can be formed through this point starting from zero. Okay, so you will have to just make a straight line following these points. Okay, following this point you will have to make a straight line so that it can make an intercept on the negative x-axis. Okay, so in this manner we generally make the double reciprocal plot. So I have prepared the same plot on the graph paper. Okay, so this is for your convenience. Okay, so as you can see here, I have plotted the points and it is giving me a straight line, but the line is also intercepting at the minus x-axis. Okay, so in the zoom form you can see it right here. So 0.001 is giving you reading at 0.0041, then at 0.0011 is giving reading at 0.0044. Similarly, 0.00125 is giving me reading at 0.0048, and then at 0.00143 is giving me reading at 0.0052. Okay, then at 0.0062, then 0.0068, then here and then here. Okay, the readings I have mentioned here are till this point. Okay, this 0.002, 0.005 point. Okay, it is just above, this is 0.040. okay, I have plotted it here. This is 0.00020 and this is 0.005. okay, so this is the last second point which I have plotted here. Okay, I have zoomed the graph, so this is the points you can see. Okay, now this is the plot, this is the double reciprocal plot that we have plotted. Okay, if still you are having any kind of doubt, you can comment in the comment section. I will definitely try to solve it. Now what to do with this graph, how we can calculate the km and vmax. Okay, so the first thing will be the calculation of slope. Okay, let me take it Okay, so we have this equation in our hand, which is Lineweaver-Burk equation for double reciprocal plot. Okay, and these are the points which you have. Okay, now simply we will have to calculate the slope. Slope is Km by Vmax. Okay, so how you can calculate the slope from this graph, okay, which we will discuss now, and then we will have to calculate for Km, and then we will have to calculate for Vmax. Okay, so first we will calculate the slope. Okay, first we are going to calculate the slope. So the general calculation for slope is y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. Okay, y2 is the, so we will have to take two points on this graph. For example, I am taking this 0.068 and 0.05052. Okay, I am taking these two points. Okay, and now we will calculate the slope. Okay, so 0.0068 is higher than 0.0052, so this will be y2, and 0.0052 will be y1. Okay, similarly, the x intercept for this point is, for 0.0068 it is 0.002. okay, similarly for 0.0052 it is around 0.00143. okay, I have taken it from the observation table. Okay, so just calculate it as 0.0068 minus this point minus 0.0052 this point. So this is your x2, this is your x1, divided by 0.002 minus 0.00143. Okay, so this is the way we generally calculate the slope. If you want the detailed video, you can definitely go through that video I have mentioned earlier. So after calculation, you will get 0.0016 divided by 0.006, and the slope will be 0.266. Okay, this is the slope of this double reciprocal plot. Okay, now if you have the slope, we are having the slope of 0.266. okay, now we will calculate for Vmax. So as I have already told you that we get y intercept of 1 by Vmax. Okay, I have told you this thing, if you remember that this thing, that the intercept we get on y axis is 1 by Vmax. Okay, similarly the intercept we get right here is for 1 by Vmax. Okay, so 1 by Vmax will be equal to the intercept we got. For example, here we are having the point at 0.0013. okay, so this is 0.001, this is 0.0012, sorry, 11, 12, and this is 13. okay, this is 0.0013. okay, this is the y axis intercept, which is 1 by Vmax. Okay, so if you have to calculate the Vmax, simply reverse it, 0.1 divided by 0.0013, and the answer will be 769.23. okay, and the unit for maximum velocity is micromole per minute. Okay, so the unit for maximum velocity will be in the form of micromole per minute. Okay, so we have calculated the Vmax by this method. Okay, the main aim of plotting the graph was the slope. Okay, the main aim of plotting the graph was the slope, and also the y-axis intercept that we get to solve for the Vmax. Okay, now talking about Km, so as I have told you, slope is Km by Vmax. Okay, and the slope we have is 0.266, and the Vmax we have is 769.23. Okay, solving it for Km, you will have to simply multiply the slope with Vmax. Okay, and finally the answer will be 204.61, and the unit will be in microgram per ml. Why microgram per ml? Because Km generally gives you the substrate concentration. Okay, Km is the Michaelis-Menten constant, but as you can see here, the point we get is on substrate concentration axis. Okay, this point generally gives us the Km, but for more accurate data, for the proper interpretation of Km and Vmax, we go through this method by taking the slope and then solving for Vmax and finally for Km. Okay, so the Km you will get is, sorry, I Okay, I think you have not visualized this properly. I make you clear it right here. Slope is Km by Vmax. So the slope is 0.266 Km divided by 769.23. Solving it for Km, you will get 769.23 multiplied by 0.266, and the final answer will be 204.61, and the unit will be microgram per ml. Okay, so in this manner we can calculate the Km and Vmax from the double reciprocal plot or Lineweaver-Burk plot. Okay, so finally from the double reciprocal plot, the Vmax and Km for the given alpha amylase was calculated to be 769.23 micromole per minute, which is the maximum velocity, and 204.61 microgram per ml, which is Km. Okay, so I hope you are clear with all these things. If still you are having any kind of doubt, do let me know in the comment section.